Hello, and welcome to today's webinar, How to Regain Design Freedom and Source the Perfect Linear Guide with Extruded Profile Guide, brought to you by Design World Magazine and bishop-wisecarver. My name is Lisa Itell. I'm an engineer editor with Design World Magazine. I'll be your moderator for this informative session. Before we begin, let me explain how you can participate in today's presentation. First of all, if you have any technical difficulties during today's session, simply ask for help through the question box on your GoToWebinar console. Also, get social and share information from today's session. Tweet or post on this webinar and hashtag your post to join the conversation with hashtag DWWebinar. Also, we welcome your questions. Just enter your questions as they occur to you in the question window on the side of your GoToWebinar console. We will answer as many questions as possible during the Q&A session that will follow the main presentation, but please feel free to type in your questions at any time. At this time, we thank our presenter, Brian Burke, for being here. Brian has more than 10 years of experience in the automation industry and has extensive knowledge of processes for CNC machining, lean manufacturing, equipment implementation, and product development. Brian holds a Bachelor of Science in Manufacturing Technology from California State University in Chico and an AA in Industrial Drawing from Bakersfield College. He is a Six Sigma Black Belt. His expertise is in manufacturing processes and the work methods used in the creation of products. At bishop-wisecarver, this includes the layout of machinery and the design of tools and fixtures used to produce, inspect, and assemble products, as well as CNC machining processes. Now let me pass the mic to Brian. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Lisa, and to Design World for hosting this webinar. And definitely thank you to the attendees for joining us today. Here's a brief overview of what we're going to go into. If you're not familiar with bishop-wisecarver, there will be a brief introduction and an explanation of the range of our products before we get into the main topic here, which is how to regain design freedom and source the perfect linear guide with extruded profile guides. We'll have an interview of, we'll have an overview of what we mean by extruded-based profile guides, and then some ideas of how to simplify your machine designs by integrating multiple features into those profiles. And I'll give some information about typical project timelines and some real-world application examples. Bishop-wisecarver is a certified woman-owned company, and we're located near San Francisco in California, and we've been in business for over 60 years with many unique clients across the country in many different industries. We have two subdivisions. One is Black Diamond Manufacturing, or BDM, and the other is WRW Engineering. So in Black Diamond Manufacturing, we are a contract manufacturer for new product introduction, transitions into manufacturing, specialty machining and manufacturing, and kitting and subassemblies. In WRW Engineering, we provide turnkey system solutions, embedded intelligence systems, industrial controls and programming, as well as other project management services and engineering services. All of our business units are AS 9100 certified and ITAR standards for privacy. And in addition to that, all of these business units are certified Bay Area green businesses. So at bishop-wisecarver, these are our main product lines. You may have heard of some of them before from our advertisements or past experiences. Our main product is dual V motion technology, the linear guide wheels and tracks, and they are the building blocks of our other product lines, including low pro actuators, utilitrack linear guides, and quick track linear guides. We have quite a range of products to offer, and the dual V components you can see at the top left-hand corner, those are individual pieces and parts which our customers use to build machinery, equipment, and fixturing, and they can be individual pieces designed into a machine. As you work your way towards the right-hand side, we sell sub-assemblies like in the utilitrack where we attach those guide wheels to machined bearing blocks, or what we call wheel plates. and then also the linear tracks that go with them. And as you work all the way over to the right, we can combine those into complete turnkey systems, XYZ gantry systems, where the power transmission is also included. In the case of that low pro example, there's a belt actuator on the X and Y and a screw actuator on the Z. We also distribute in North America HEPCO Motion products, and what's unique about them is the ability to do rings as well as straight profiles. And the same idea down there below, we do the individual pieces and components, so a ring or a section of a ring or a linear track, all the way up to complete assembled and driven systems, like in the DTS driven ring and track system there for high speed, high frequency packaging applications. So dual beam motion technology, the core of all of our products, is really designed for high debris environments and very long applications. They're all guide wheel based, and they provide very smooth, low stiction, low stick slip motion. They roll and slide across the track, and so there is very little effort it takes to get them to begin moving. They're really good for long lengths and heavy debris environments, and they can be very high accuracy and repeatable on position. And they can achieve very high speeds up to 5.5 meters per second. And they come in a variety of different materials and sizes and load capacities. These products are used in a variety of different markets. Likely you'll be familiar with some of these, but where they're most suited and most common is in packaging equipment and package machineries, but they're also common in paper and converting, bakery equipment, aerospace fixtures, any type of assembly or production machine, you're likely to find these products as an individual component on the inside. So quite a broad adoption level of these. Okay, with that overview out of the way, let's take a look at our main topic. Here's a little bit of a problem statement here. If you're designing a computer-controlled equipment, this can be used in many different applications. Perhaps you're the design engineer putting together some material handling equipment, or you're developing a 3D printer. Maybe you have a CNC router or milling or laser engraving machine, or it could be a medical device or tabletop factory, some kind of piece of equipment. There's many different applications where you could use these products. These projects can become very complex. They're electromechanical assemblies, and the design engineer must integrate a variety of parts. You have electronic parts and mechanical parts. Perhaps you have motors, electronic drives, control boards, sensors, you know, all of these different items that you need to integrate into your machine. The mechanical side, you'll have the frame, perhaps an enclosure to keep the debris under control. You may have doors and guards. Power transmission, like gear racks or belts. You could have pulleys or chains. And also, of course, very important, the linear guides. So many different pieces in your project. So the typical design requires a lot of decisions. The design engineer and machine builders have to look at each one of these. On each of the parts, do we make them or buy them? Do we want off-the-shelf pieces that are standard offering, or can we handle custom parts? Do we want domestic or foreign suppliers? There is a big push to have American suppliers, and so that might be a requirement. And what parts or functions can be integrated into a single piece? And that's another decision that's very important. So when you set out to design a machine, usually the first step that happens is a survey of the market for existing parts. The selection decision will be based upon what you've used before, what your past experiences have been. If it worked in the past, you would be satisfied with using it again. If it didn't work or you had problems, you might want to try something different. Maybe you would base your decision on what someone told you from a word of mouth or a reference. I have no experience in doing that, but my friend told me it was a good idea, so I'll give it a try this time. The other one is, what's readily available? What can I find on the market easily that looks like it's well adopted? And so that's usually how you would start with designing a new machine. But when you do this process, you're selecting from what's already available. You know, you have to review the technical specifications. You need to look at the shape, the size, the load capacity, even the materials. And sometimes you'll have to configure those or modify those as necessary. You know, you'll have to buy what's available and then make it fit your application. It's never perfect. It's not the ideal shape. It's not the ideal size. Maybe it won't fit into your machine or the other parts you've already designed. Maybe it's an incorrect finish or colors. You don't want to put something in there that's fluorescent orange when the rest of your machine is black. And oftentimes it will require secondary modifications. You'll buy it from a manufacturer. You'll have to add additional holes in order to mount it later. So these are all the things that limit your design freedom. You have to take what's on the market and apply it to your equipment. With extruded profile guides, you can regain some of this design freedom. You can design and source a tailored linear guide specific to your application, and this would really help you stay ahead of your competition. It could reduce your bill of materials complexity, have a lot of flexibility in the lengths of these profiles, and it can help to secure your supply chain. You could stay ahead of your competition because your competitors can't simply go to the same supplier and order the same parts and build the same machine. This protects your intellectual property, your design. It reduces your BOM complexity because there's fewer products in there, and we'll look at how those are integrated and some ideas of how we can integrate multiple pieces and simplify the bill of materials. Flexibility and length. A single profiled extrusion can be cut into different lengths to form different machine sizes within the single family. And you can also take control of your supply chain. If you develop an extrusion profile with the linear guides integrated for your application, when you need more material or run out, you can simply have more produced. You are never subjected to having those materials be obsoleted by the manufacturer. Okay, so let's take a look at some of the bishop-wisecarver extrusions. We take an extensive use of extrusions in our production processes for automation. Here's an example. This is our low-pro linear actuator. It has the dual-B guide wheels on the wheel plate carriage, and this one happens to be a belt-driven version. But there are many extrusions that are special purpose, specially designed, and finished machined for end use. Common on the bottom, the T-slot support beam. That is used to attach the low pro to the machine, base, or frame. The idler end and the drive end are machined from the same extrusion with different machining requirements, one with bearings on the outside and on the idler end, bearings on the inside. Also, the wheel plate originated as an extrusion and was a special purpose machine. Here's a closer look at some of those. The drive end with the drive pulley on the inside and the idler end with the idler pulley, made from extrusions. Also, the track plate. We mount dual V track, the long linear steel track, to a machined extrusion profile to make a track plate assembly. Down below, we have support beams. Those are specially made support beams for low pro. And on the wheel plate, those are long extrusions that are finished machined to an end purpose. So with that expertise, we see the need for having aluminum extrusions with tracks installed. We typically would machine the extrusion and then attach it with bolts and screws. But a recent development is to integrate the features into the extrusion. In this case, we attach the steel linear guide track to the aluminum extrusion directly. But here are some of the other features and machine components that you could integrate. Of course, the linear guides, like I just mentioned, but you could also have attachment points for power transmission and linear encoders for position feedback. You can have secondary machining operations as necessary. You could do threaded end holes, and you can incorporate T-slot features, and you can also incorporate features for cables and wires. The way the track is installed is based upon quick track modular linear guides. We have a patented technology where the track is mounted using a tredge into a support extrusion. These came out about 2 years ago in two different profiles and two different sizes. The double edge has two tracks installed, is inherently parallel, and the single edge has one track, and the single edge is meant for spanning wider distances, such as on doors or guards. So how this works is the track retention method, there's small fingers in the extrusion, and these fingers are down the entire length. They hold the track in with no adhesives and no glues, and the track can be seamless up to 20 feet long. And with this method, we mount hardened and polished steel track into aluminum support extrusions. But on the quick track version, with those two different shapes, that limits some of the design freedom, and so we have new methods for attaching those to any profile shape or profile design, like the one you see on the right-hand side. By incorporating these features into your machine, you can simplify your machine design. You can apply this patented track retention method to a custom extrusion. Define your perfect extrusion profile, the exact shape you need, the exact size you need, the finish that you want, the color that you would like, and then you can integrate machine components and functions into that profile and save on your BOM complexity. So let's take a look at what you could incorporate. This slide looks like a little bit of a repeat, so I'm going to skip ahead, but this is the introduction to what we are going to see as the features you can incorporate. Of course, incorporating the linear guide, we include the 90-degree V guide tracks, and those are typically carbon steel hardened to 53 Rockwell at a minimum and polished. These are permanently installed without fasteners or adhesives, leaving the factory with nothing for you to do or for your customer to do, and they can be seamless up to 20 feet long. Another integrated feature that you can design in is T-slots. T-slots are general purpose attachment points common on many different extrusions. There's many different standards out there, but you can develop your own or base it off of what's pre-existing. These are used for machine frames, bases, doors, guards, all different kinds of applications. And you would want to design and size it for the right T-nut hardware. Maybe you want to have a 10 millimeter T-nut to attach to another frame. You can design the T-slot yourself and include that feature. Holes. Holes are a general purpose attachment point, and you can design these and size them for thread tapping. This would simplify the assembly, and it helps to make a rigid structural attachment point. You can also use extruded holes to convey liquids and gases on the inside of an extrusion. They would be ideal for thread tapping and mounting essentially tube fittings or hydraulic fittings and conveying materials through the beam itself. You can incorporate areas for power transmission, a dedicated location on the extrusion for attaching perhaps a gear rack. All you would need is a flat surface and a reference edge. There's many different methods of attachment, and some common methods are using adhesives to attach the gear rack, or you could drill and tap threads down the linear length for attachment. As you can see on the right-hand side, this rack has holes in it, or you could mount it over a T-slot feature with T-nuts. You can see on the picture on the right-hand side, it's mounted up against a reference edge and uses the T-nuts on the beam to secure it below. Also on the application on the left-hand side, you see a little reference edge on the bottom edge. That's a location for attaching a gear rack. Okay. You can also integrate dedicated features for feedback, a place to attach your linear encoder. A flat surface with a slight reference edge, and most of the time these linear encoders have self-backed adhesive on the backside of them, and you would clean and then attach those encoders at those locations. So if you want to develop your own extruded profile guide specific to your application, it might sound like a long process, but let's take a look at our typical development time. It starts with the product concept, and that would come from the design engineer or from the customer's requirements. When that information is communicated to Bishop-Wisecarver, we refine that design, which could typically take about 2 weeks, and we work with our extrusion companies, our extrusion providers, on the die design, and we develop a complete production quote. And at the end, we have an overall finalized design. So that can range anywhere from 2 to 6 weeks in duration. Phase two would be the production of the extrusion. If everything is okay in phase one and it's approved, we would begin the fabrication of the extrusion die. And that could take approximately 6 weeks, including the scheduled first production run. Optionally, you can do a first article inspection of a minimum amount of quantity from that extrusion for approval or modification, and then you can schedule the complete production. You also need to include some shipping and transit time. You would get a range of 10 to 12 weeks. Phase three would be production to final assembly. We would receive those extrusions and cut them to the finished lengths. We could do those operations, including machining and thread tapping of the end holes, attachments of the linear guides, applications of racks or adding linear encoders, and then of course transit time for an estimate of 1 to 4 weeks in phase three. So if you look at the total overall range of lead times, the average would come in at around 22 weeks. And the minimum, if everything was well-defined and fairly simple and easy communication back and forth, it could be in the neighborhood of 13 weeks. So how would this secure your supply chain? If you develop an application for a very specific extrusion, you can stay ahead of your competition. They can't buy these same products, and you preserve your intellectual property. You can produce these quantities as needed. They're never obsoleted from the supplier. If you co-develop an extrusion die, you own the design of that die, and you would be the only person able to extrude that profile. And you can source complete subassemblies, simplify your purchase orders, and assembly documentation. Instead of having an exploded bill of materials with many different parts, many different torque specs, and application requirements, you can have a single piece part come to your factory pre-assembled under a single stock code. So now let's take a look at a few actual real-world examples of extruded profiles. This is a CNC router machine based on aluminum extrusions with pre-installed dual V guide track. On the picture on the left-hand side, you can see the very large cross-sectional beam on the Y-axis is used as the main machine frame. And then they also attach on the bottom the other extrusion that we've been using in our examples as a long X-axis. Let's take a closer look. You can see the beam is threaded on the end holes, on the extruded holes, for attaching to the steel flange. This is the construction method that they decided to utilize. Also, on the right-hand side, the T-slots are there for attaching different machine features, as well as a rack attachment up against that reference edge using adhesives. So power transmission is also included. Here's another real-world example. This is a camera slider for cinematography. You can see that they would mount a camera to a tripod on guide wheels and be able to move the camera to achieve what they call parallax. That's where the background is moving and the foreground is moving at a different speed, making it very interesting to watch. This extrusion was custom designed for that application, and it includes T-slots throughout, as well as holes and cavities for making the extrusion lighter and more portable. Okay, so as you can see, we went through the Bishop-Wisecarver introduction and a quick explanation of our products, but with extruded profile guides, you can see how you can regain the design freedom that you have lost by sourcing from existing products on the market. We looked at some of these processes, the extruded guides, and also some of the ideas of how you could simplify your machine by integrating features into a single piece, into a single part. And we also looked at some of the project timelines and a few application examples. Okay, so this is a new product from Bishop-Wisecarver. We're very excited about offering this. And we have a new white paper, which is also available on our website, that gives you a little bit more detail about the extrusion process and the die shapes and features that can happen. So if you go to this location, you can download the white paper. Okay, and with that, I'd like to open it up to any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much, Brian. Sorry for interrupting you while you were mentioning your white paper. We have a few questions, so let's jump right in. First question, how accurate are linear guides?
Yeah, extrusions are subject to warp and twist, and there are industry standard guidelines for these values based upon the size and cross-section of the extrusion itself, but typically a few thousandths of an inch per foot are possible. When precision is required, secondary machining to achieve around 2/1000ths of an inch may be required along the entire profile. So the end accuracy is usually specified by the application, and we can take additional actions on the extrusions to ensure that we meet your precision requirements.
Okay, fantastic. Next question, what's the minimum quantity requirement for sourcing an extrusion?
Yeah, the minimum quantity requirements, in looking at this as a possibility, it might seem prohibitive. You know, you might have the assumption that you need a whole lot of material. But our extruders, we use small batch quantities with production runs of around 100 meters at a minimum. 100 meters is about 330 feet. And if you base this extrusion off of you use this extrusion on several different machine designs, you can consume that much material easily in a single machine build cycle. And there is no upper end of that. There's no upper limit. You can push more as needed.
Fantastic. And this is a related question. What is the maximum length?
Maximum length, you start getting into limitations with shipping. And so we have trucks, and a typical truck shipment will be about 50 feet long. I believe they're about 52 feet inside of the trailer. And so that's about as long as you could do a single piece. Our dual bead track is 20 feet long, and so a typical extrusion would be 20 feet long and cut down to smaller sizes. In our low-pro product line, we actually attach the tracks end-to-end for unlimited lengths. We have done actuators up to 80 feet long. Those are shipped out in shorter sections and attached in the field location.
That's fantastic information. I believe the same attendee is now asking, what's the maximum height?
The maximum height, typically within extrusion die, you have to spin the diameter of a press. And on that large CNC router application that I showed, the circle is about a 9-inch diameter circle. So anything that fits within the extrusion press's capacity is possible.
Excellent. The next question is a bit specific, but I'll present it anyway. What kind of analysis are you using that lets you guarantee for the belt life or the life of the belt in the drive that it will withstand the load and thermal specifications of the application under continuous use? Under continuous use.
Okay, that's a pretty specific question, more targeted at the low pro actuator where we had the belt and the drive methods incorporated. On the extruded profile guys, we show a rack as an application, but in your design, you could use a belt. And in that case, we have calculations for low pro, which show essentially the tensile strength of the belt and the shear strength. But the life of those products are not typically calculated. We do the calculations of the actuator itself and the guide wheel itself as the failure component, as it's actually a ratio of the amount of load versus the amount of travel for the estimated travel life. But if something very specific needs to happen in that case or a specific guarantee, we would do a testing or validation phase to ensure that it would meet the required life. I hope that answers that question.
Excellent. Last question I have in the hopper, how parallel are these linear guides?
How parallel? I answered that question just a few minutes ago, but the parallelism when the track is installed will mimic the extrusion. And an extrusion is typically very parallel, but it can warp and twist down its length. But oftentimes they can be, when mounted, straightened back out. So you're looking at, if you needed a hard number on that, somewhere around 5/1000ths of an inch per foot maximum. And so if you did some machining or other precision operations, you can get it to around 2/1000ths of an inch.
Excellent. A few questions popped in while you were speaking.
Okay.
Are any kind of coolants used for these types on these long range applications?
Yes, in the case of the dual V track and wheels, we always recommend lubrication, and a simple lubricating oil is appropriate for that, but you can use almost any lubricant. In the case of, say, chicken processing, where some of the material can fly around inside of the machine, you can have food grade greases or other types of lubricants, but we always recommend lubricants. In the case where lubricants are not possible, there are some dry lubricants where you can spray them on. The VOCs evaporate away, and it leaves a little film of lubricant there. But definitely adding lubrication increases the life of the recirculating bearing, and it lowers the friction and inhibits corrosion. So we always recommend lubrication.
Excellent. Next question. You mentioned 100 meters. Is that the minimum requirement for an order, or is there a stocked or standard item?
In this case, for a custom extrusion for your application, a minimum push would be 100 meters. But if you needed to, if you could commit to the 100 meters, but you wanted to order only, 20 meters, we can hold that material here and process it as needed. So it would be held in the raw state and processed as needed in smaller quantities. The other profiles that I showed, which was the quick track, where we have the four standard profiles, those are shelf stock items. Those are ready to be shipped out upon placement of order. But this webinar was focused on how you would develop a custom extrusion profile for your application.
Fantastic. Well, I think that concludes the webinar. Another thanks to Brian, and thank you, Bishop Wisecarver, for being our sponsor. The on-demand version of this webinar will be emailed to everyone later today and will also be live at Design World Online shortly. Sincere thank you to you all for joining us.